You ever hear the Academy for Troubled Youth? No? Well, you're not alone. I never heard of it either until I stumbled across it doing research for my next project. And while I personally believe all schools are torture, from what I read, this was an actual torture school where kids were brutalized daily. You see, I'm an independent journalist, and my area of expertise is uncovering forgotten stories from America's dark past and bringing them into the light of present day. The idea for this latest story came from a posting I saw on Reddit. There was this one guy who wrote about the worst school in the United States. He explained how he was one of a handful of survivors who made it out of the place he called Hell on Earth. He talked about countless instances of abuse, starvation, neglect, torture, and even murder. He detailed how not only the state where the school is located went out of its way to completely scrub any proof that it ever existed, but the government did as well. I spent hours searching the internet for anything I could find on the Academy for Troubled Youth. There wasn't much to go on other than an old photo of a school with the same name that was taken back in the 1960s when the school first opened. That school closed its doors abruptly in 1981, the same year the Reddit writer had claimed. With my interest piqued, I reached out to the Reddit writer to question him directly. He was reluctant to speak to me at first, but then I said to him, "If what you're saying is true, wouldn't you want the world to know what you endured?" He agreed, and that led us to an impromptu interview that lasted for 2 hours, but could have gone on for several more. His name was Roger, and he had me hooked on his every word. This guy was fascinating. Now, I couldn't be sure if he was being totally honest with me or not, but his story was incredible. By the time we got off the phone, I was 100% committed to finding out what really happened. Unfortunately, to find that truth, I'd have to travel to a small town in northwestern Indiana where the school was reported to be. Normally, I do my research from the cozy confines of my apartment by way of internet, but like I said before, every online avenue hit a dead end. I have to do some good old-fashioned investigative journalism if I wanted to get a hand on this story. It's a lot of work, but my subscribers expect nothing but the best of the darkest from me. And if that means going out to verify whether or not this tragedy had been deliberately buried in the deepest annals of American history, then that's what I was gonna do. My subs are worth it. Besides, there's no telling what kind of publicity I could get if this all turned out to be true. During our phone conversation, Roger, the Reddit writer and alleged Academy survivor, gave me a bone-chilling recount of everything he could remember about the school. I recorded the call so I could review it later. I must have listened to each gruesome detail 100 times in the days following our talk. I listened to it during breakfast, in the shower, and while I was laying in bed, even falling asleep as I listened to it every now and then. I absorbed every word of that recording. Within a matter of days, I knew the ins and outs of the Academy and felt ready to embark on my journey. It's a good thing I was so thorough too, because Roger refused to meet me there. I offered to pay him to be my tour guide, but he said he'd sworn to himself that he'd never step foot in that godforsaken place ever again, and nothing would change his mind on that. So this was going to be a solo mission. Well, not quite. I'll be taking a trusted ally with me, but other than that, I felt more than ready to go out and either debunk or verify Roger's assertion. Incredibly, the location of the Academy couldn't be found online. I called Indiana's public records office and they claimed they didn't have an address for such a place. Thankfully, I was able to reach Roger again, and he was able to give me the exact location. He also warned me that I shouldn't go there, especially by myself. He said there's something evil about that place that goes beyond human understanding. I thanked him for his concern, but in the back of my mind, I wasn't interested in all that supernatural bullshit. I was more interested in finding out why there was so much secrecy surrounding this place. I drove for 11 hours, listening again and again to Roger's account of what went on inside the school he referred to as hell through my AirPods like it was my favorite music playlist on loop. I didn't know what to expect when I arrived at my destination, but I gotta say, my jaw literally dropped and goosebumps covered my entire body as an eerie chill coursed through me when I finally set sights on the dilapidated construction that towered above the landscape before me. I was face to face with a place once known as the Academy for Troubled Youth. It existed after all. And thankfully, it was still erect. I was happy that I didn't just waste a half day of driving for nothing. The next step was actually going inside the school and seeing how much of Roger's vivid descriptions of this place correlated with the actual interior of the building. It was make or break time, no turning back now. Either I was about to become the world's biggest horse's ass, or I was about to shine a bright light on one of our country's darkest secrets. I grabbed my backpack, my camera, clipped my wireless mic to the collar of my shirt, and hooked the transmitter to my belt. "Here we go," I said to myself as I emerged from my car. I popped the trunk and removed my trusted ally. My Smith & Wesson 9mm was going to be my sidekick on this little endeavor. I wasn't about to go into an abandoned building without some kind of protection. I hoisted my steel baby to my hip and shut the trunk. Now I was ready. I took a few outside establishing shots. This was the educational section of the school. Since they were wards of the state, the kids lived on school grounds. From what Roger told me, this is where over 400 children, ranging in ages from 14 to 6, were housed. Once I got everything I needed outside, I found a broken window to crawl through since every door I came across was chained and padlocked. And while the outside of the school was creepy as shit, the inside was far worse and downright disgusting. The air was utterly foul. It smelled like a musty, mildew-ridden porta potty that hadn't been dumped in years. I should have brought a breathing respirator. There's no telling what breathing this toxic shit in is doing to my lungs. I slowly moved through the vandalized and graffiti-covered walls, capturing everything I could through the lens of my cannon, hoping to God no one jumped out at me from the seemingly endless line of doorless classrooms. I have to give it to Roger. There was something extremely haunting about this place. I felt like I was being watched. But maybe that was just my nerves getting the better of me. On the plus side, everything so far was perfectly lining up with everything Roger told me about the school's layout. One of the first places I wanted to see was the nurse's office. To get there, Roger told me to take the hallway straight down from the main entrance and turn right. There I would find a set of stairs. Right at the bottom of those stairs was the nurse's office. I followed his directions precisely, and to my surprise, the nurse's office was right where he said it would be. Holy shit, this guy's for real. He'd actually been here. This story just graduated to the next level. The nurse's office. A place where you'd think kids were under the care and watchful eye of a licensed nurse. That's what I like to believe anyway. But according to Roger, this is where the physically broken children came to be patched up only to be sent back out to their abusers by a cold, vicious woman who claimed to be a nurse but did nothing to heal those in her care. Kids would come to her with bleeding wounds or severe bruises and all she'd do is put a band-aid on it and tell them not to mess with it, never doing anything to clean their wounds to prevent infection, which often occurred later on down the line. According to Roger, when kids became severely ill, they would be taken on a trip to the scariest place in the school, a place where there was no return for those who'd been sent there. Fractured ribs and broken bones were also common injuries the nurse failed to treat properly, simply wrapping those kinds of injuries with gauze, then telling the kids not to be so clumsy, totally disregarding the child's claim that it was an abusive teacher or aide that caused it. She never reported a single case of abuse to the authorities, thus letting the violence against the defenseless children carry on without check. And if a kid continued to complain of their pain after being treated by the nurse would cruelly and forcibly place the back of that child's hand on a steaming hot radiator. Her favorite quote of choice when she did that? "If you insist on crying, I'll give you something to cry about, you little brat." It broke my heart to be in that particular room. To imagine kids coming here for help only to be met by a monster who didn't give a damn about them. A miserable old bag who refused to lift a finger to save any of them, and instead chose to inflict her own degree of punishment on them before sending them back to their abusers. The despair all those kids must have felt is unimaginable. The next room I wanted to check out was just as bad a place, if not worse. Outside of the nurse's office was the flight of stairs that Roger told me to take up to the very top floor. There I would find another door off to the left that led up to a small attic. It was this room that the janitor of the school at the time called his home. It was also the place where Roger said he and dozens of other children were violated on a regular basis. The room was mostly dark, but there was a small bit of light coming in from three windows. The light coming in from those windows revealed a flat, dingy old mattress in the far rear of the attic. From what Roger told me, that was the janitor's bed. It was also the place where his 9-year-old self lost whatever shred of remaining innocence he had left. For those who tried to fight off the janitor's unwanted physical advances, he would put them in a suffocating chokehold and threaten to throw them out the window and make it look like a suicide. That was usually all it took to make his young victims comply. As I stood there, looking out of the windows that overlooked the decaying landscape from 4 floors up, I could actually feel the terror a small child would have felt if they found themselves up here with a sick and perverted man. All alone, a world away from anyone who would hear their screams of agony. But as terrible as this place was, there was still one more stop on my list. And that was the one place that all kids who attended this school feared most. The place where kids seemed to vanish into thin air once they were taken there. That place was the basement. Now I won't lie to you. As I made my way back downstairs, getting video and photos of random classrooms along the way, I felt a rising degree of trepidation about going into the basement. I'm not the superstitious type, but I was beginning to feel like I wasn't alone. The closer I got to the area where Roger told me I need to be in order to access the basement, I felt more and more like I was being watched. Like someone was just behind me, on the side of me, even out in front of me, staring at me from the shadows where the dimming incoming daylight failed to reach. But despite my reservation, I pushed through. I kept my mind on my gun the entire time. I was ready to pull and fire at the drop of a dime if I had to. I just hope I wouldn't have to. The instant I made it to the basement stairwell, I started to feel like this had been a huge mistake. I didn't belong here, and something inside of me was telling me to get the hell out. Another part of me knew I'd come too far to turn back. I had to go down there. I just had to. The basement smelled of pure mildew, stinging my nostrils with every breath I took. Once I emerged from the narrow, winding basement steps, I came upon a pitch-black hall that ran down as far as the light of my camera could reach. By sweeping the light of my camera from side to side, I could see there were doors on both sides of the hallway. All of them were wide open. That made the hairs on the back of my neck stand up. I pulled my gun and held it at the ready with my right hand, carefully balancing my camera with the left. Following the directions I memorized from my conversation with Roger, I knew exactly where I wanted to go. At the end of this long-ass hallway, there should be a single door at its end that would lead to another sub-level. That was the place where the severely ill, severely injured, and most problematic kids were taken, only to never be heard from again. Roger couldn't tell me why that was, but here was my chance to possibly find out. Right where I expected to find it, there was a final door at the end of the hall. This stairwell was the scariest thing I'd seen today. It literally looked like it led to hell. The only way to get through it was to hunch over, and even then, it was a tight squeeze. When I made it through, the sub-level opened into what I viewed as an unfinished dungeon. Dirt floors, wood support beams that were connected by walls of spiderwebs, and chipping brick walls that made the creepy dungeon vibe complete. I gazed around, instantly thinking that this was probably the place where they killed and buried all the children that gave them problems. But that's when the light of my camera shone on it. Built into the wall at the base of a smokestack was an incinerator. It was in that moment I knew the horrifying truth. I walked over to the incinerator and pulled the rusted door open. Loaded with ash, there was no doubt in my mind where all the missing kids went. The sick bastards who ran this place cremated every single child that threatened to blow the lid off their little school of horrors. I had all the disturbing details and verification I needed. It was time for me to get the hell out of this sick place and tell the world about what went on here. There was no longer a doubt in my mind that Roger was the real deal. I slammed the incinerator door and began to retrace my steps with a hurried pace out of this dungeon crematorium and back up to the basement. The second I made it to the basement level, I immediately noticed something was off. There were lights on. How could that be? There was also a noticeable change in the air. It was a lot colder than it was before, and the smell of mildew had been completely replaced by the stench of rotting meat. The odor was commanding, suffocating and nauseating at the same time. As I tried to figure out just what the hell was going on, the door to the sub-level slammed shut behind me. That scared the living hell out of me, causing me to nearly jump out of my skin. As I backed away from the sub-level door, I noticed something from the corner of my eye. I looked around to make sure I wasn't tripping, but all that did was confirm what I feared. Every door in the narrow basement hallway that was open before was now closed, every single last one of them. Who or what could have done that? Cause it sure as hell wasn't me. Not wanting to find out, I carefully made my way back through the hall, training my gun on every door as I passed, just in case someone wanted to jump out. No one did, but I found myself being scared shitless when something began knocking heavily on the other side of all the doors. I took off running, desperate to get back to the main floor. I bolted up the stairs, and that's when I heard a terrifying guttural growl behind me, followed by what sounded like someone or something running up the basement stairs chasing after me. I let off a frightened yell and practically leapt up the remaining four steps to the main floor. I slammed the door behind myself and something ran into it from the other side hard. When that failed to break down the door, whatever it was began doing this creepy fucking knock. "I got a gun, asshole," I yelled. "You come through this door and I'ma shoot your ass." The knocking stopped, but that's when the whispering started. I mean, it was everywhere, all around. It sounded like I was surrounded by people I couldn't see. "Fuck this shit," I said to myself, holstering my gun. It was time to get the hell out of here, double time. I ran through the hall, and just as I was about to round one corner, I was scared half to death when I saw a woman standing at the end of the hallway with her back turned to me. I stopped dead in my tracks, my heart beating through my chest. "Hello?" I said, my voice trembling with fright. "Who are you?" The woman said nothing and never turned around to face me, but somehow, she began racing towards me like she was floating on air. I took off running in the opposite direction. I found myself back at the nurse's office, only this time the door was closed. I didn't think much of it until I saw shadowy figures pressing against the glass from the inside. "Holy fuck," I screamed, taking off in the opposite direction, praying the floating woman wasn't too close behind me to block my path. After some frantic running, I finally found a window that wasn't boarded up. I smashed the glass with my foot and jumped through. I landed flush on my side in the damp grass, nearly smashing my camera, my gun pressing uncomfortably into my hip. I got up in a hurry and made a hard run for my car. It was only after I got into my car and got it started and rolling that I was finally able to breathe a sigh of relief. It was then that I felt safe enough to try and wrap my mind around all that had just happened. I expected the academy to have a shady past, but I never imagined the fucking place was haunted. It took nearly 10 minutes for my heartbeat to return to normal. The more distance I put between myself and that school, the safer I felt. When I finally got home, I didn't know what to do first. Well, that's not true. The first thing I did was jump into the shower in a frantic effort to wash any remnants of that place off my body. I even snorted some soapy foam to get the smell out of my nose. It burned like hell, but it worked. Later that night, I decided to do more research, since a peaceful night of sleep was definitely out of the question due to the horrendous nightmares I was all but guaranteed to have. Because I couldn't find anything on the internet about the Academy for Troubled Youth, I was left with no other choice but to expand my search into a place where I never thought I'd go. I went on the deep web and found out that the school was built over a burial ground that was created as an exclusive resting place for a private and extremely wealthy group of elites who were reported to practice Satanism. It is believed that a mutual organization that those dead elites owned back when they were alive funded having the school built over their burial site so that it may one day serve as a gateway that would connect our world to hell. It's alleged that there was a contract signed with the state that would prevent the Academy for Troubled Youth from ever being demolished, no matter what condition the building was in. Wow, that explains why that condemned piece of shit is still standing after all these years. And on a side note, I was able to uncover a few more terrifying bits of information from the deep web. Remember the cold-hearted nurse who worked there? Roger told me they used to call her Nurse Jones. I wonder if that could be Janine Jones, who is currently incarcerated for the murder of several children, crimes she committed shortly after the academy was closed. And the janitor, who the kids only knew as Chucky? That could possibly be one Chuck Sittens, who was arrested and convicted in 1983 for another tragic incident involving a 9-year-old girl at another school, 2 years after the academy closed. Everything about this story is heartbreaking, and what's worse, what happened to those poor children at the hands of those monsters years afterwards didn't have to happen if the state and those in power didn't cover up the horrors that were carried out in that school on their watch. I'm going to share this story with the world, and I hope those who are responsible for allowing it all to happen are held accountable, if they're still alive. But the very first thing I'm going to do is reach back out to Roger, and hopefully give him the closure he deserves, and let him know that I'm going to give him and his former classmates a voice to speak out about all the wrongs that befell them, and speak against the system that failed them. But above all else, I'm going to tell Roger what he and all the others should have been told more than 4 decades ago. I'm going to tell him, I'm sorry.